Sounds like we're about ready to get started. Good afternoon, GDC Europe. How are you? Come on, how are you? Having a great day today. My name is Matthew, and it's a pleasure to welcome you here to this exclusive GDC presentation of The Witcher 3 Wild Hunt. I just came in from Warsaw, Poland yesterday, so I'm incredibly excited to be here and so excited to share what I have brought for you today. First, I'd like to welcome all of you, before we get started, back to the Witcher 3 Wild Hunt experience by showing you a brief trailer titled Go Your Way. For those that are new to the story, The Witcher is based on a series of fantasy novels by Polish author Andrzej Sapkowski. Through this incredible story, players experience the life and the adventure of Geralt of Rivia. Amongst the last of his kind, Geralt is a professional monster slayer with uncanny mutant abilities. Known to the people simply as The Witcher, we join Geralt's story as he sets off across a long journey across the Northern Kingdoms. In addition to the mystery and the intrigue of this fantastic branching storyline, Witcher presents a role-playing game that enables the player to tell a story all their own. And that's what I'd like to share with you today. Starting with an overview of The Witcher's base game design, we're going to dissect some of the fundamental systems that define the game's role-playing experience. And as we do, we're going to consider some of the problems that we encountered, why those problems appeared, and how they were approached. Finally, we'll consider the state of the game at its release and the feedback that we received, perhaps from some of the people sitting here in this room today, the community online, and all the feedback that they gave, and how the change has been integrated with the game because of it. Now, because investigating this set of core design mechanics will take us into a more deep appreciation of what's been learned, I hope you'll be able to take away some lessons that you'll be able to integrate with your own designs. Now, when you set out to develop an open world game, the most important experience to deliver is this design that encourages the player's freedom to explore. And that's because open world games are all about exploration. They're about immersing the player within some massive world that provides an unprecedented feeling of open space and the freedom to explore it all. Unfortunately, the truth is, roaming free across entire regions where the players explore without interruption is, well, it's boring. And nobody wants to play that game. In fact, one of the biggest complaints that most people have with the open world genre is that, at times, all this running around just kind of going from point A to point B in order to progress a quest can actually become quite tedious. And I think that's why role-playing games blend in with this experience so perfectly. The player is given all this freedom with nothing to do until, hey look, all of a sudden there's a monster on the horizon. Or a chance to experience a merchant's small crafting collection, or maybe a set of components that you hadn't experienced before. A rare sword with magical abilities, a new set of armor that could complete your collection. These moments are what add the character and the depth to the world that takes the player's immersion to the next level. These game mechanics can provide skill-based interactions to what might otherwise be an uneventful experience, but I find it's the compelling nature of that role-playing that seems to keep players captivated. Focusing on dynamics like risk and character progression, RPGs aren't about reaching a destination, it's really about the player's journey and what they experience along the way. The key to that motivation is keeping the player rewarded for their actions, and a reward that matches the challenge that they've just overcome. To do that, you must first understand each system. In the game, in order to eliminate exploits and establish a balanced experience that the player can understand, that they can anticipate, and eventually overcome. By introducing an economy, we're actually providing a system in which resources can be produced, consumed, and exchanged in quantifiable amounts. However, in many games like The Witcher, intangible resources like health, experience, and skill are also a part of that experience. And they can easily be considered a spendable resource, just like money, goods, and services. And this creates a problem where, as you try to identify each item and how they relate to each other, it makes a difficult choice, kind of a gut decision regarding whether this is more worthwhile than the other. Now, as we take a look at the Witcher economy, I'm going to share with you some of the ways that I use to approach these types of problems and some of the challenges that they present. See, the game economy, I tried to break down, is fundamentally just two concepts. There you have resources, and you have entities. And in essence, all economies are going to revolve around resources. That's the center of what they do. They come and go, they're bought and sold, they're created and destroyed. It's always about resources. And by resources, I'm referring to anything that could be measured numerically, which means basically almost anything in your game could be known as a resource. Money, stamina, ability points, everything is an example of a resource, as are the items, upgrades, and even enemies that oppose the player. And while not all of these resources are under the player's control, anything the player can produce, gather, collect, and again, destroy, is probably a type of resource. Additionally, resources are either tangible or intangible. Tangible resources have physical properties in the game world. They exist at a particular location and often have to be moved somewhere else. Examples include items that Geralt carries around as inventory or alchemical herbs in the world that can be harvested. Intangible resources have no physical properties in the game whatsoever. They do not occupy space, nor do they have a particular location in the world. For example, once a player defeats an enemy in battle, they are rewarded with experience, which is intangible. Like crowns, experience is just a number. It doesn't exist in the world. For instance, the player doesn't need to physically manipulate experience in order to achieve a new level. Simply having the right amount of experience is enough. Now, the second concept of game economics is called an entity. And entities are used to store specific quantities of a resource. For all the programmers and scripters in the house, you might just consider an entity a variable. Essentially that, nothing more. An entity named level, for example, explores the resource level or the current level of experience that the player has obtained. The player has an entity that stores Geralt's crowns resource. As Geralt buys and sells gear, gains rewards, and so on, the amount of rewards or crowns in the entity tend to reflect those changes. Now that we have a solid understanding of both resources and entities, we'll take a look at the four economic functions that I use to create the Witcher economy. And as we do, I'll identify each resource and how it's affected by each function as they move around the economic system. The first function is sources. And by sources, what we're talking about are mechanics that function just as their name implies. They are a source of new materials and creating resources basically out of thin air. Their primary function, be it at a specific time or under certain circumstances, is to generate new resource and store it in an entity. Sources may be triggered by events in the game, switched on and off, or even be set to operate continuously, producing these resources based on a specific production rate. In The Witcher, for example, sources of these can be found as containers that the player can loot. You can see at the top of the screen, Geralt doesn't recover from health naturally. That means once damaged in combat, you'll need to drink a potion or eat some food to regenerate over time. That is also another source of, a resource for health. At that point, you can also see sources in the form of flowers and plants, herbs that Geralt can harvest to collect, alchemical ingredients that will be then used to make mutagens and some of the other potions and decoctions in his arsenal. The second economic function is the trader. Traders are a mechanic that move resources from one entity to the other. And as that resource comes back in the opposite direction, it comes back according to some rules of an exchange. The concept to remember here is that when dealing with a trader, nothing's really created or destroyed. The process is simply exchanging resources between the entities. In The Witcher, you can see this mechanic at play in the merchants Geralt visits to sell junk items or purchase new gear. How does it work? Well, let's say during this interaction, the player buys a sword from the blacksmith for 10 crowns. At that happens, the trader mechanic then transfers the crowns to the blacksmith from the crowns entity, and then transfers that sword from the blacksmith's inventory directly to the player's inventory. One of the issues we had with this mechanic was that as players travel to different trader types, a blacksmith, herbalist, book dealer, etc., they may be able to sell all of their goods every time. The problem with that was we were trying to create some level of believability in this universe, some realism, at which point it just didn't make sense for a poor herbalist who had been living in a war-ravaged world of no man's land to be interested in purchasing a rusty sword from Geralt. And as stated earlier, there needs to be some rules for this exchange, rules that would provide some control over who and what could be traded. Additionally, I needed rules to affect the price because, in short, sometimes an item's real value is quite different from what the item is worth. One side note regarding The Witcher is that everything to do with the economy and game balance came on incredibly late in the production. In fact, it was the last thing I worked on before shipping the game, considering there are hundreds of merchants already in place in the world and crafters that needed balancing and adjustment. It needed to make some big changes and something that would save a lot of time, something that would save me problems or not create bugs down the road. And I had to make some tough choices on how to proceed. So because I had a lot of ideas, not only content side, regarding how I wanted that system to work, and that I'd probably be making some mistakes, changing my mind, and needing to manage these options going forward, I decided to create a tool called Reactor that could do this calculation of each price modifier at runtime. So the power of Reactor isn't necessarily more than a simplified approach towards how the rules we're going to exchange were going to be determined. By comparing a matrix of data points regarding the item, its category, how rare it is, and where it came from, I was able to put this against the type of merchant Geralt was trading with, where they were located, and any discounts that might already been gained by completing quests. And the results were outstanding. Very quickly, instead of presenting a single static value per item or per armor, the prices were calculated at runtime, making every trade unique. What this did was it gave the feeling that the player was trading with a real merchant in an active economy, where each item would present a different value based on the contextual state of the world around them. Additionally, it opened a new dimension to the experience where more ambitious players could utilize this system to trade items across multiple regions at favorable rates. For instance, a blacksmith that gives preferred rates for rare weapons and magical upgrades, but is not interested in purchasing books or alchemical ingredients. As another example, in Skellige, a land where villages are hardy and well-fed, grain and meat can be purchased at reasonably low prices. Players can bring these foods back to No Man's Land, a region ravaged by war and famine, and then trade those same goods for a very large turn of profit. Creating this matrix of all possible values, what I did was be able to store this data, in a sense, inside the code, and then access that data very quickly using a hash map that allowed me to return any value at near constant runtime. Followed with a single pass in the editor to then mark up each merchant and item, these actors were given tags and a single callback to get price modifier. This returned how each actor should react based on the given series of weighted percentages or the rules of the exchange. This brings us to our third economic function, which is drains. And it's pretty easy to figure out here. Drains are the opposite of sources, right? So the sole responsibility is to take resources out of the game, reducing the amount stored in the resources entity and removing them permanently. Unlike the trade function, with drains, the resource is not saved. It does not go anywhere or turn into anything else. It simply disappears. In The Witcher, the crossbow bolt is an example of a drain. This is not, you're not able to retrieve these resources. Once you squeeze the trigger, the bolt flies and is gone. Thus, you must go to a crafter and replace it, spending more money, thus draining you economically. Additionally, the trader's function price modifier we just discussed is a drain. Affecting costs involved with common interactions, drains unfairly burden the player's budget and work to reduce their purchasing power over the course of the game. Its only purpose is to prevent the player from attaining infinite wealth. And drains have also been used to increase the cost the crafters charge for services, a dynamic drain that scales progressively as the quality of the item increases. While the players will never understand and secretly kind of hate you for taking all their money out of the game, it is one of the key resources and controller mechanisms that we as designers can use to make sure that we're able to always buy for more and sell for less. So as kind of a rule of thumb, anytime I'm thinking of a system, whether it be an existing feature or something new that I want to make, the idea is to try and figure out a way to put in an economic drain. Finally, we'd like to discuss here this economic function of converters, where you're basically turning resources from one kind into another. In The Witcher, this is the act of crafting, where the converter mechanic converts resources into swords and armor at a very specific rate. And for me, this is where the real fun begins. Like traders, converters require values and rules that define the exchange. For The Witcher, these rules were defined by an item schematic. The real problem here is that a large degree of interpretation with creating a schematic starts to occur as the armor and swords become more complex. The number of ingredients mixed with the selecting type of a leather or an ore mixed with the number of plates or chainmail or wire to hold it all together, it all becomes increasingly complex to craft even just a simple chess piece at times. It's almost pure speculation. Then there's this additional concern where you're trying to take each item and balance it against each other, put a cost to it, make sure that everything is relative. This is all very, very difficult, and even for the best of designers, you don't want to be out there just making guesses. So to reduce the complexity of these decisions, and again, I was out of time, so I needed something fast. What I did is I just redefined my entire approach, and for this, I used a new system of game design that I call Witchcraft. And while it may sound like magic, Witchcraft is actually a system of tools, guidelines, and metrics that simplified my design process. It helped me eliminate exploits, and it helped automate content generation. In short, it was my attempt to take a more scientific approach instead of basing all of my decisions on gut instinct alone. Let's take a closer look here. Using the structures we've just defined, it's not particularly difficult to identify what resources and entities comprise an economy. But it can be difficult to get a good perspective on that system as a whole. In effect, this is what witchcraft was all about. Again, the idea was to base my decisions on models of data instead of gut instinct. And what I was trying to say is that in order to truly balance a numerically based system, I found it to best visualize the data trends rather than working on a per item basis. For instance, if you were to plot points on graphs based on the amount of damage a sword deals versus, say, the cost of that item, what shapes would those graphs reveal? You can ask questions like, is the amount of given resources increasing over time? Are these increasing consistently? Are resources distributed evenly, or are there some progression stoppers where something has been more overused than another? Targeting concerns and visualizing the results is key to understanding the structure of your economy, and it's going to help lead you to the results. The answer, this is all a bit generic, so what I did is kind of prepared a slide from one of my actual data sets. And here, just like in the real world, I've represented this feature of the economy with some charts and data points that I've plotted. In this data set, you can see the rate at which spending was increasing as the quality of each item approaches that category and ceiling value. Now, at the small scale, individual points may appear to move chaotically, but from this greater perspective, I think we can all see this pattern that's emerging, right? This process identified anomalies in item pricing, and the curve acted as a recommendation from which I could make additional adjustments. And while it often required several iterations before I'd get the exact curve I was looking for, I found this experimentation led to results I hadn't considered before. For instance, you can see how the curve ramps up quickly and slows over time. Think about the impact for a second that this would make, say, on the early game experience. Something where even a small increase in quality could result in a very large increase in the player earning. What I feel is like this behavior I was looking to do, what I was asking is this the behavior I was looking to achieve? Is this the type of progression? You know, I wanted a linear, do I want a quadratic, something exponential? What was I looking to achieve with this data? Again, we're not just manipulating numbers here, but we're actually trying to describe a world that tells a story. And because the Witcher's fantasy is so grounded, all the armor is so real, the lethality of the damage, the monster design, everything is so based on things that we can appreciate. I kind of felt like this economy couldn't just show up with a $10,000 sword in a place where they can't afford to eat, right? So that economy needed to feel poor as well. And I also wanted items to increase in value so that by the end of the game, you were kind of feeling pretty badass, right? You were feeling tough because this thing really was expensive and you really had achieved something to earn it. With these goals in mind, I actually started to tune curves in a different way. And I think it becomes apparently clear now how by reducing the rate of growth until the end of the game, relic items would continue to increase greatly in value, what I was doing is kind of stunting the player's growth, in a sense eliminating the need for money altogether. They were finding things in containers and they would visit the stores and they could choose to buy that, but if they didn't really have a lot of money, this became this gray area of what do? Do I disassemble something? Do I repair something? Do I buy something new? Do I hold out for the next level? And for me, this is where I started to realize that I had not just solved some problems, I had kind of created some emotion within the game. In a sense, the players were feeling a bit worried, a bit panicked, that maybe they wouldn't be able to have enough, that maybe they'd have to grind, or maybe they'd have to complete some more quests. And at that point, for me, that's what role-playing games are all about, right? That's where you're not really just pushing buttons. It's where you're there inside the world, inside the character's mind, trying to figure out what is the next best thing. So while visualizing the data was a large step forward in predicting how pricing was going to affect the player's progression, in addition to all these other things I learned, I found the curve had other uses as well. For instance, by pre-calculating the coefficients and storing these data in a table, I was able to procedurally generate these curves at runtime. Now, instead of simply visualizing how a set of custom data points fit into my curve, this functionality actually allowed me to generate an infinite set of points that fit the curve exactly. Not only did this change simplify my design process, but by auto-generating content, I eliminated hundreds of existing bugs and prevented all new bugs from appearing. I had been poring over thousands of hardline coded values in XML, and now I was able to remove this data completely, a process that reduced load times and decreased the footprint of every item in memory, an upgrade that saves me, personally, countless hours of overtime during crunch and a very critical time during the project. Now, having won multiple awards for the Game of the Year, The Witcher 3 Wild Hunt is undoubtedly an example of creative expertise. But that's not to say that the game was shipped without problems. I mean, let's face it, all games have bugs present in them. It's just the nature of what we do. But with open world design, there are a lot of systems, both large and small, that aren't present in the average game. Many times, these systems must perform across hundreds of hours with frequent interactions between them. So if any parts are incorrectly placed or implemented, glitches will be prevalent in the game. For instance, not long after The Witcher 3 was released, many of us on the team started scouring the internet and social media channels for issues and exploits that we might have missed. And it seemed like every single morning I'd come in and there'd be another conversation at the water cooler about some hilarious video or a hack that players found, where some additional conversation would go by and we'd start talking about how to approach the fix. Unfortunately, the majority of the forums and videos were focused on a number of economic exploits with my design that allowed players to quickly build up their bank accounts. Now, the first method involved slaughtering cows in the starting area of White Orchard for their valuable hides. A source function, as we all understand now, the cows were actually set to infinitely respawn to ensure that, from a level design perspective, the player would always arrive into the village and see a very healthy community full of animals and people. With no limitations placed on that situation, This actually just created a situation where it was only a matter of time before the players would collect and sell enough resources to destabilize the economy in a very early stage of the game. What I think The Witcher did right here was not only to resolve the exploit, I think that's a given. What I feel was extraordinary is how it was done. See, following the patch, if players are caught exploring this exploit, the cowhide problem, that is, well, let's just watch. I think that was actually a fairly common experience. In case you don't know, that's it has multiple names. This one was a chort, and it actually had somewhat of a cow modeling on it. So what we were able to do is kind of reutilize an existing boss asset from later in the game and bring it into where players were generally quite feeble. So having something that might have been, you know, 7 or 10 levels higher than you all of a sudden became something where it was quite a penalty. In fact, it would just chase you down and kill you no matter where you went. And what I found was that, you know, the solution not only, you know, fixes the bug and it penalizes the player kind of in this way that is fun. And in a way, it's almost like this bonus feature. People who cheated get this unlock for the special content. And, you know, it probably just played last night, hit the upgrade button, download the content patch, and all of a sudden came back for the regular payday and ended up losing very quickly. Lovingly named the Bovine Defense Force Initiative. It was probably the most beloved bug I've ever fixed and resulted in a lot of appreciation from the community. So that was a lot of fun. Similarly, in the first expansion, Hearts of Stone, any player who took part in the questionable money-making tactics might have been surprised to get a little visit from a tax collector by the name Walthamore Mitty. You see, Walthamore Mitty knows about your undocumented income and quickly explains that he's heard reports of Geralt quickly coming into large sums of wealth. To maintain the Witcher style players are familiar with, they're actually given a choice to make when these accusations are raised regarding their behavior. For example, you can tell the tax collector you know nothing about these accusations, or you can admit to having participated. I don't want to give away anything for anybody who hasn't played this content, so I'll just stop there. What I feel The Witcher did right here was not only identify the bug, they listened to the community. And watching what they'd done, they came on and solved that problem in a way that also enriches the player's story with a bit of humor, an engaging plot twist, and a simple decision, and some meaningful outcome, which I think are all basics and fundamentals to creating a great RPG. Along with this list of bug fixes and minor feature improvements, the Hearts of Stone expansion introduces a powerful new type of craftsman known as the Runewright. When we first met to discuss concepts regarding how to expand the base game, we had been spending so much time fixing things, you know, it was a real chance to sit back and consider something fresh and new. We quickly arrived back to this original concept that we had, but just never had a chance to implement. It was called the rune words. And the idea is that because you set all of these runes into the blade, instead of just some sockets that we have, you know, to use in the inventory to kind of make it explainable and easy to handle in the story, you know, we see this picture of Geralt as he's walking iconically out and his Witcher power is like surging through the blade and these runes are coming to life with Witcher sign magic, right? It's a really, really cool concept that we just didn't have a chance to really realize as we had hoped. And with this feature, maybe this was our chance. In order to unlock powerful buffs and add to their combat abilities, you know, it was clear that we were all excited to finally put this mechanic into the game. And while working through several of versions of the design, unfortunately, there's a bit of disagreement regarding how exactly we'd like to see the system play out. Also, while we were continuing to iterate on this design, I was receiving a lot of feedback from both QA and still the online community that more players were completing the game with an excess of something like 20 or 40,000 extra crowns, and they had no way of spending the money. Too many. This sounded kind of like a bug or something that in some way, you know, was an indication that there was still an imbalance players were exploiting. But to be honest, I wasn't convinced. With that in mind, you know, what's happening here? See, one of the problems with balancing open world economies is that even if the system is statistically balanced, there's this additional layer of level design to consider. And with that in mind, you know, you've got multiple people working on the experience. You have multiple reasons that they're touching the content. Some people are placing it for gameplay perspective, making sure that the player has extra things to do, making sure the world feels alive and interactive. Others, they go through from a purely aesthetic sense. They're placing containers and unlockables and rare chests because it looks right and it fits the environment. It makes it feel real. Other players, they're filling the world with quest content that's going to reward the player from these challenges and from the time that they've spent. All of these things coming together ends up being very difficult to manage because everybody, in a sense, is right. You know, they all have this reason to be placing this content in the world. But also, that wasn't just the issue. The real issue here, I think, is that we, as designers, have no way of predicting what type of player that we're going to get. And by that, I mean, like, how much of this content that we're creating are they going to pursue? Are they more of a casual player who's only focused on getting through the game, or more of a hardcore completionist who will seek out every last reward, place of power, and lootable container in the region before advancing on to the next quest? The problem is we don't know. And the question then is, how do you deal with it? Because we want everyone to have fun. That's clear, right? It's decided early on that whatever we do, the content kind of has to be based around places where the player is going to automatically be. We want casual players to enjoy the looting process and leveling up and finding upgrades and unlocking cool pieces of armor just as much as the hardcore players that are specifically there to find them. So for those that put in the time, this resulted in a tendency to over-reward the player. That if they pick up even a portion of what we've placed along the quest locations, they'll actually have more money, gear, and upgrades than they would need to finish the game. In fact, they would have plenty to continue playing well beyond the end of the game. And with that in mind, we need an economic drain to start preparing the player for what was going to come in Hearts of Stone. We needed to take away some of this advantage that they had, but also maybe provide a way of augmenting their skills and abilities in a way that would compensate for the level 32 content that we were going to drop on them. And that's when it was suggested that we would combine these two issues into one big new feature called the Rune Rite. The Rune Rite is actually something that must be earned by completing a quest and can then be improved by investing in new equipment. This will in turn unlock more powerful enchantments, but you need some serious cash to progress through the system because, I don't know, looking at it in a variety of different comments, that 20 to 40,000, we kind of put this limit at maybe about 30,000 that most people would have or maybe some slight grinding in order to attain. So as an example, the level one, where you're just investing in this beggar in the street, you're giving him $5,000 and some quest pieces to open up a shop. Now, if you want to engage the level 2 content, that will take a little bit more investment through another $10,000. And finally, if you want that top-tier level 3 enchantment, it's going to cost you another $15,000 for a total of $30,000. Surprisingly, most of the players that I've seen start to say whether or not it was worth it. And I think what's interesting is, in a way, we hit that mark very, very closely. Most people had just enough money to immediately go through so that by the time the new DLC was released, they were kind of starting where they should be. One of the things I think The Witcher did right here was to make enchantments free. That, considering the initial investment was quite costly, this is logical as in the story as well as the gameplay, right? The Runewhite, in a sense, owes Geralt this debt of gratitude for putting him back in business and restoring his ability to craft all these enchantments. But more importantly, I find this encourages the player to experiment with all of these new abilities that they've just acquired. Now, when we set out to design the Witcher 3 Blood and Wine expansion, we wanted to take you on a fantastic journey that would go far beyond the war-ravaged villages of No Man's Land and the stormy beachfronts of the Skellige Islands. Taken directly from the pages of the Witcher dark fantasy novels, the final chapter of Geralt's saga welcomes you to the Nilfgaardian realm of Toussaint, the enchanting and mysterious land of wine. Heavily inspired by the beauty and the pageantry of the French-Italian countryside, Beauclair, the region's capital, blends rolling hills, winding roads, charming villas, and intriguing new characters to create a colorful and vibrant landscape unlike anything that we've seen in Hearts of Stone or The Wild Hunt. Now, from an RPG perspective, this was a huge opportunity for us to add something unique as well. Reports we had received from our internal QA department were identifying concerns with character progression, where players were unable to use the ability points and inventory items that they had acquired. Also, feedback collected from the Witcher Online community had resulted in a list of requests for improvements to the user interface and new gear that would augment character abilities. After almost a year of the game's initial release, we felt it was time to tackle some of these bigger issues and, as it was the final chapter in Geralt's story, maybe have a little fun along the way. And with that in mind, along with its new region and mysterious storyline, we decided that Blood and Wine should introduce some all-new role-playing game mechanics as well. Starting with the user interface, we saw a lot of improvements, both with manageability and improvements to the crafting system, where the player is able to add a variety of components without having to leave that interface. We also added a new mutation system, which, when used in conjunction with other ability buffs, adds an entirely new dimension to the way that you play. We also added a brand new design to the items, where as we were placing things through the world, it became clear again with quest designers needing support, with arts needing support, with gameplay needing support, we needed a chance and a rule set maybe to keep all this content placing consistently. Finally, we started looking at an all-new die system where we were giving players the ability to customize the color of the Witcher's armor sets. Perhaps the biggest change of these was the mutation system. It introduces a new RPG design, and while this mechanic was originally added to compensate for the expansion's high-level requirements, we ultimately found that it was able to address a lot of other concerns as well. Primarily, the first is related to character progression. See, as players run around the Witcher's vast open world, they encounter a variety of different monsters and enemies, some of which are extremely powerful and require players to achieve a high level in order to defeat them. Encountering these types of situations encourages the players to progress in order to overcome the challenges and acquire the rewards that await. This is one of the things that I feel sets The Witcher apart from some of the other RPGs on the market. See, instead of increasing the strength of each monster and enemy, based on the level of the player, the difficulty is fixed and at times can overwhelm even the most talented Witcher. The key takeaway here is that to ensure the player actually feels like they're getting stronger, there's some things that we want to be careful to deliver. The problem with continually scaling enemies is that by basing them on the player's level, the player may never actually feel that they're progressing, that as that same challenge progresses, they're progressing, and you get this kind of arms race where you end up with a very flat and normalized experience as the game runs through. In The Witcher, character progression is limited by a combination of experience and ability points that limit the games that they complete story quests, side quests, and Witcher contracts. In the beginning, this limitation forces the player to plan and carefully select its abilities in order to build strengths that focus on their particular playstyle. Unfortunately, based on the feedback that we had received, as players were increasing a level, this progression curve was actually peaking too early. This was leading to a disappointment in the end game, where players were feeling little to no progression at all. The issue was actually a flaw in the way that the skill tree was designed. In this example, you can see here that once all the skill points have been allocated, once all the skill slots have been filled, and their abilities maxed out, the player has no motivation to continue leveling up. And this resulting effect is that as players progress, they will continue to accumulate ability points that cannot be allocated within the skill tree. Also, if you look along both sides of the skill tree, you'll see that four monster mutagens all are suffering from the same problem. These slots have been filled and with no way to continue utilizing them. As Geralt continues to defeat boss-type monsters and collect these powerful items, they will just simply continue to stack up inside the player's inventory. And to resolve these issues, we came up with the mutation system. See, mutations are powerful abilities that can be added to Geralt's skill set in addition to his regular character skills. With 12 mutations in total, and each one embodying a very specific skill type, whether it be combat, alchemy, science, or a blend of these types, the players are able to choose how they progress once again. In order to activate a mutation, it actually has to be first researched, which also costs an increasing amount of both skill points and greater mutagens. Additionally, these mutations build on each other, which focuses players to unlock the lower mutations before advancing to the more advanced options that are made available. And although they are labeled as game-changing abilities, with effects like free respawn on death, several could be considered more of a game breaker. And in fact, one of my personal favorites is a freezing effect that it adds to the Art Sign ability, where either they're frozen or they completely explode in like frozen jibs and fly all over the place. It's a real blast. Finally, when the mutation is equipped, the Strength and Synapses ability also expands Geralt's base skill tree with one additional ability slot for every two mutations that he researches. Putting all of these things together, the mutation system turned into a massive step forward in regards to resolving our issues with character progression, as well as fixing and making more fun inside the player's skill tree. We are able to eliminate concerns with unused inventory by providing the player new opportunities to spend the ability points they had collected. And by focusing on monster mutagens, we were able to expand the need once again for the alchemy system and further encourage the player to invest time in the monster hunt mechanic. In addition to resolving these issues, this decision provides the player with new motivation to continue leveling up, but also, importantly, it further immerses the player within the Witcher's Monster Slayer fantasy, making it a perfect addition to the existing role-playing experience that we had created. Now, considering this vast change in dynamics that Blood and Wine brings to The Witcher 3, we felt it would be a lot of fun to bring some of that color into the crafting system. One of the last big features to ever be added to the game, this introduces an all-new coloring mechanic that presents some surprises for multiple departments on the team. See, one of the biggest requests we were getting from player community was for additional customization of Geralt. Considering many RPGs let you design the protagonist of the story from the outset, a lot of players were feeling discouraged that they weren't given more options throughout the game. And while everybody was on board with the idea, there was a technical issue involved with how player armors were designed. See, instead of using two channels to separate the colors, you know, the same process that we use to randomize NPC appearances, character artists had made a very early decision to focus on delivering high-quality assets that would only use a single-channel process. This required me to modify several code paths that had not been touched in years, which presents a lot of concerns as we no longer had an in-house expert to consult if things go wrong. Additionally, new textures and materials would have to be created not only per armor, but per armor piece before these new code changes could take effect. But putting together a prototype, I was able to finally modify the Griffin armor and demonstrate the quality and number of new assets that we could generate from the game base mesh. The best part, I feel, is that once released, not only is this kind of a huge step forward in providing the player with a completely new level of customization that they had not yet known before, but playing with the different color sets, it seems clear that this is going to make the decision kind of put in their hands. We're not just simply releasing these things and allowing them to purchase one or to decide which one that they want. This is something where they're running out into the world and deciding how do they want to expand. Even if they have one, maybe they don't like mismatched armor. Maybe they want to get all of the dies in order to complete a full set. And then once they find them, it is possible to then go through, along with some new technical improvements to the UI, and actually apply these as they wish. We also include like a die remover, which if you did make a mistake or prefer to undie something or mix and match however you want, that's also a mechanic that you can incorporate into your play. Also, this came with a new preview mode where you could present these colors on each mesh individually before you actually apply them. And this was nice so that if you had the idea of mixing colors, as I was just showing you, two or three different colors in a single armor set, this would allow you to see how each color plays out on each different piece of armor. You know, thinking back over all of these new features, for me, I'd say this one was my favorite. Unlike an ancestral sword that kind of deals more damage, or a piece of relic armor that provides a greater resistance to injury, with no impact on player statistics whatsoever, this feature is all about experimentation. It's about having fun and realizing the player's story that they wish to tell. Based on all of the community feedback we've received over the last year, I think this game mechanic is one of the best decisions that we made, and a special thanks from all of us here at CD Projekt Red to you, the best fans in the world. Thank you very much. I think we have a few more minutes for any questions and answers that you guys would like to do, or everybody ready to get out of here? Okay. Oh, we have a microphone going out.
Hello.
Hello.
Don't you think it's a problem if a player is so engaged and want to play all additional content because it's so diverse and so well designed, he kind of gets punished by getting too much money, too much experience, making combat too easy?
I do think that that's a problem. I think it's also kind of a reward. In a sense, the system's working exactly the way it's been designed, right? If you want to go out and you want to earn a lot of money and you want to buy and craft a lot of equipment, this should give you an advantage. I do think that there's an option to place limits on the player, but a lot of people, they've asked this question a lot, actually. A lot of them do want to simplify the system with maybe some systemic or procedural solution where perhaps, you know, if you're collecting equipment from a chest and you're too high level, just like, trying to collect experience on a lower level monster, you don't get anything. So maybe in this chest, you don't get anything. And for me, I'm kind of a huge proponent of player agency, where they should be allowed to do whatever they want and have that rewarded based on level of challenge it took to acquire that. And so if we were to start taking away that agency and saying they're just playing too good, or you know, they're being penalized because they have enjoyed the game too much, I think that would actually complicate the situation even more. So a lot of different things to consider, a lot of moving parts, but I agree, yeah, some limitations could be placed there.
Hello, my name is George, and I just wanted to ask you, because a lot of systems you just introduced, like the mutation system, indeed helps anti-aliasing unused points. My question is, why did you allow the player to have access to that system on a particular quest? Because at the beginning of Blood and Wine expansion, I was feeling at the beginning that I keep my points for no reason, and somewhere in the middle I just have to spend them somewhere because I just found that hidden alchemy that unlocks the system. Why did you introduce it there and not in the beginning?
I think there was really no choice unless we forced it upon you. And while that's possible, I think this is a reward for players that are more interested. If you remember that slide we talked about, like the casual versus the hardcore, that I feel like instead of just supporting the hardcore, this is actually supporting maybe like to the mid range, where chances are the casual player won't be interested in this mechanic anyways. Even if you gave it to them, they'd say, okay, well, I've got skill points. I don't know if I have time. I just want to get back to this really great thing where I'm having sex on a unicorn. This is awesome. And you know, I don't know that that would have made such an impact. And yet, for players perhaps like yourself, you did feel that moment where then all of a sudden you had all these skill points and you felt that reward when you did unlock that quest. So whether it came too early or too late, the emotional payout was there. And I think that's something that you wouldn't want to jeopardize, however you would go about fixing it.
Thank you.
Have some questions in the back here.
Hi. You talk about removing resources from your economy. How do you deal with the problem where potentially, say, for example, someone buys lots of crossbow bolts and then wastes them on an enemy without getting a proper reward from that? How do you deal with that potential problem?
Yeah, we actually have basically two types of ammo. Where you have your standard bolt and you also have kind of an underwater harpoon. And both of these are not going to do as much damage, right? You can, in a sense, craft some legendary versions of the exploding bolt, which is really, really cool looking. It does a massive amount of damage. It's a little expensive to make, and they have limited capacity, which I feel enhances the skill-based nature of the game. Now you do have to save them for the right moment. You do have to pick, you know, the quality of exchange so that you're getting the most out of your investment. And of course, if you ever run out, you go back to the lower damage version of which you have an infinite supply. Any other questions? No? Okay. Well, wait, one more.
Hello, my name is Marie. I wanted to ask about the trophies, because I still have all these trophies in my storage. Did you ever thought about system where a player can put them?
I think that's only a matter of time issue. A lot of these things that you're talking about are things that weren't a part or a concern as we were just trying to finish the game. Along with the DLCs, we did expand these concepts. And in Blood and Wine, we have Covro Bianco, which is the new home that Geralt kind of settles down in. You know, if I had a chance to go back in and revisit some more content, that would be an opportunity to add more value so that as the player is upgrading this, you know, and they're getting these ability bonuses, you know, there's just one more reason for it to be called home. Okay, anyone else? All right, well, thank you so much for your time today, everybody. Have a great GDC.